Good evening. I'll call the Portsmouth School Board public meeting February 19th, 2019, to order. The superintendent could take the roll.
Jeff Landry?
Here.
Tara Kennedy?
Here.
Gary Epler?
Here.
Ann Walker?
Here.
Kristen Jeffrey?
Here.
Patrick Ellis?
Here.
Nancy Claiborne?
Here.
Brian French?
Here.
Roseanne Vazella Clark?
Here.
Thank you very much. If we could all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Is there anyone here who would like to, from the public, who would like to speak to the board? Seeing none, we'll move on. So we have one item on our agenda tonight, and that is final consideration and approval of our FY20 budget. Steve, you want to give us a quick summary?
Sure. So I think at the last school board meeting, I know I handed out a slightly updated version of the running list that we had. I have extras, and I'll hand them out in case you need it. And this is just, again, to give you a reminder of some of the itemized adjustments to your given budget book we did. But we've had a target all along in this process, which has been to look at what the council had considered as a status quo budget, which in terms of numbers came in at $49,496,691. And then consider what the council had considered and heard from various departments for what was about $1.4 million worth of new initiatives presented. And again, we were in a very draft form of that conversation at the time. But anyway, the council had given guidance to the city manager to pare that back to about $900,000 of additional requests across all departments. So we met with the managers, with the other departments, and came up with an appropriation for us of that amount, about $253,736. So, and that was based again on what our initial piece was, but then reducing from there. So it brings us to a total goal, if you will, FY20 proposed budget of $49,750,427, which represents about a 3.5% increase over FY18 or FY19. And then, of course, the council does sort of set out there a collective bargaining contingency. That's obviously not a hard number that's out there, but just to set it to understand that there would be additional fiscal impact based on various collective bargaining agreements coming to fruition. And if you were to include that into the budget, at least as the council has outlined it, we'd be at about a 4.8% increase. But the number you'll be voting tonight isn't with the contingency, because that's not determined yet. It would be that other number of $49,750,427. So that brings us back to the sheet, which again, I don't want to confuse you, because there isn't any total on the sheet of the running items that would take you to that full budget figure. But again, this was just a list of things that either were already in your budget as presented, which we knew was too high, or things that we were considering that weren't in there that could go in there. And then on the right, some of the running adjustments we were making to get to the target number of which we're at right now. So I wouldn't focus too much on the exact dollar detail on the running list sheet so much as the topics or the proposals themselves. And if you have question or you have a particular issue with any of them, we certainly would look at that. Right now, this budget, and I would certainly speak to this going forward as we get into the city council's conversation, this budget hits a number of priorities that we have as a district. It hits a number of issues related to the goals you've created. So I look at just running down some of the lists around equity, our 0.6 counselor, which is an early intervention at Little Harbor, is to continue the good work of going on right there by the staff to look at how we transition our most impacted students into school and support them. That has to do with behavior, that has to do with trauma-informed education, and a lot of the work that they've been doing. The math interventionist at the middle school, also based on the data we have, knowing there is a gap of performance with particularly at middle school when we get into math, between students on free and reduced and students and not on free and reduced, as well as students identified as special education, students not identified as special education. These are things that we want to take a systemic approach to. The middle school has now a schedule that would allow more effective use of intervention, so we think the time is right to infuse a math interventionist at the middle school. And up to the high school, I would just draw your attention to what we've called a suspension para. Really, it's a I'd call it an in-school suspension tutor position. And again, here we see some of our most vulnerable students who may, through other behavior issues, traditionally been sent out of school for 3 days, for 5 days, with no real connection, no real monitoring of what academic progress they make. So our proposal would be to bring that, most of that in-house, and really give support to students. Still have a suspension, but look at what I think is in other schools as well as an in-house model to help support them, as well as reintegrate them into the community. So some of those pieces may be, if you can imagine a student caught vaping for the second time, some of the curriculum in that session could be around awareness of what vaping really does to you. So, I mean, there's a lot of curriculum work being done for some of those things as well. World language, when you have a goal about opportunity, I would sort of think about the world language proposal in that, which is where it's trying to expand the opportunity for elementary students into that area. As you recall, we already have reduced a proposal of two teachers down to one teacher, which certainly would curtail our ability in terms of implementing it, but we would just take a longer view of a phased-in implementation to our final vision of what an elementary world language program would be. Again, I'll come back to the case manager at New Franklin, which is a position that may be a little more of a behaviorist, a little more, again, early intervention, with some students and much of the same work that's going on in other places. We want to try to be more effective in intervening early with students. That position would allow us to do that. The ESL position also, we do see greater need in the students of speaking other languages coming to us and more intense need. And so this would allow us to really more effectively meet those needs. Right now we have ESL people stretched out across multiple buildings, and it's created some real difficulty in meeting all of the scheduled needs. So this would be a small increase to really have a big effect there. Some of the other things, I'm not sure I'm going to fit HB 1612 into your goals, so I'm not going to try, but or maintenance for that matter necessarily, although that does deal with our energy work and some of the good work that's gone on there. But that's a quick rundown. And again, in addition to that, we've looked at some of the ways in which we can reorganize, which we can capture some money. We have, in those operating adjustments, we have reduced the sub allocation money at the high school level, again with the assumption that that in-school suspension person would actually fill in as a substitute on days where there isn't anybody in in-school suspension. So we have some capability there. We have talked about reorganizing some of the staffing based on enrollments, knowing that we can reduce from 16.5 current sections at New Franklin to 16 sections. It actually has a slight residual benefit of capturing some space at New Franklin that is highly in need. And then beyond that, although we did not offer a retirement incentive, we do have some known retirements that gives us some net savings in salary. I think that's a quick overview of some of those items and some of the narrative we're talking about.
And just to be clear, the items in the bottom left are items that were raised but not included, not in the budget.
Right. This budget only includes 1 year of the one-to-one expansion. It doesn't include positions that were requested around instrumental music, expansion of our wellness coordinator, or an actual permanent sub position.
But the upper left here, they're all in the budget, correct?
Unless they're on the right as reduced.
Oh, right. Okay, I get it.
Any questions for Steve?
Is the CTE director, is that because you'll hire someone with...
It's essentially, because Diane carries a certain level of longevity in the district that wouldn't be afforded to somebody coming in new.
So we've been meeting now for almost 2 months talking through these budget items. I'm inclined to put the budget to a vote, but I don't want to do that without at least having an opportunity for folks to talk through any specific items that you see listed on here that you may want to call out, either for restoring or for deletion. So I guess I throw it to the board if there's anything that any board member feels strongly that they want to speak to.
Yeah. I'm basically just saying I'm pleased to see that the early intervention kinds of positions are there. We certainly have been hearing from everybody how vitally important that is, and that the behaviors are not what they used to be.
Yeah.
And so between the counseling and that, so I'm pleased with that.
Nancy?
I just have a question. Refresh my memory about the one world language teacher. Is that going to be grade 5? Is that what?
Well, it's undetermined right now. That would be, if we go forward with this kind of phase-in approach, I guess that would be the conversation to come back to what makes the most sense. And in a sense, you could start at any grade level if your plan is to move it up each time. So if you were to start at 4 next year, the following year you could do 4 or 5 and still not have a break in the continuity of experience for kids.
And you feel confident that the next year we can add another?
Well, that's why we
plan.
You know, I think the city always responds well to some phasing in of things. That's what we did with the buses for later start. I know that's what they're asking other departments to do with positions they've been asking for. So it makes sense to space this out as maybe a 2 or a 3, in fact, a 3 year. But it is hard year to year to know what the guidance is going to be next year. That's
knowing that every year that means another
54,000
plus that COLA increase to fund it for the next. It's adding FTEs, which is always the expensive part of the budget. So. Gary?
Yeah, I wanted to address the world language teacher position because a number of people worked very hard on getting that program moving. And we also had a very high quality presentation this year from a number of teachers that was, you know, very, very persuasive and so on. So it is a little bit of a disappointment that we can't fund the two, but I think we all should take some solace in the fact that we are moving ahead and starting the program. So. But I do want to just recognize the efforts of the people who moved this program forward because they spent a lot of time on it and convinced the board that's the right direction to move. So.
I think it's a notable additional item that we can point to of having a thoughtful community engagement process to review something and adopt an approach that makes sense for the district. Hopefully, if we communicate this right, there'll be support next year and the year after for the continued rollout of that program so we can get full funding that we really would like to see. Anything else?
Can I just ask one? And how does the contingency work? Will the, as we settle the contracts, the council will just allow us to add that onto our budget?
Yeah, it'll depend on when they're settled to whether it goes in as part of our proposed budget or whether it's an adjustment after the fact, in which case, you know, we'll have to have that conversation then to how it affects. So typically, you know, where we end this year, I guess, may not be the status quo starting budget we see next year.
And the unions are throughout the city, correct? I mean, most of them are.
Yeah, we're not unique. There's, I forget how many units are bargaining right now, but it's a good number. Yeah.
Looking good.
So, seeing no other discussion, I'll accept a motion for the FY20 budget.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any further discussion? So the vote tonight is on the FY20 proposed budget of $49,750,427. We have a roll call vote, please.
Sure. Jeff Landry?
Yes.
Tara Kennedy?
Yes.
Gary Epler?
Yes.
Ann Walker?
Yes.
Kristen Jeffrey?
Yes.
Patrick Ellis?
Yes.
Nancy Claiber?
Yes.
Brian French?
Yes.
Roseanne Vazella Clark?
Yes.
Thank you very much. And Steve and George, my hat's off to you guys on a very smooth budget process once again. Appreciate all the work that you've put into helping us get to where we have landed tonight. Hearing nothing else, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
I can make that motion also.
That's Jeff's job to make.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.